Amen. Philippians chapter 2, verse 12 says this in the King James Version. It says, "Wherefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and with trembling." Amen. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right. So I like participation. I want you to sit there looking at me. This ain't the game. Amen. I see you guys when you watch games and stuff like that. You ain't sitting there like that. All right. So not in church. Amen. So discipline your flesh. Tell them, we ain't going to behave this way in church. We're going to get involved. We're going to smile. We're going to laugh. We're going to shout amen when he's preaching good. Amen. And we're going to be a part. We're not spectators. We're participators in the things of God. Amen. And I'm telling you, you'll get much more out of the service than just sitting there like looking at a dead TV. Amen. Be a part. Amen. That's what God wants for your life. Amen. And I've always gotten more by being a participator. See, there's going to be, I don't know how many hundreds of thousands of people at a stadium watching a game with 22 players on the field throwing a pigskin ball back and forth. Everybody should have done this, you should have done that, man, do this and do that. Everybody's got an answer, big hot dog, panzon, everything else, cold beer and everything, talking about mustard here. You know, you should have did this, you know. I can't believe it. I would have. Well, you're not there. And you're not in shape and you're not on the field. Amen? And so stop it, amen? So, are you with me? There's 22 men down there on that field, and then 70, 80, 100,000 people in the stands watching them work. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Amen? And they're not sitting there, you know, they call them fanatics, fans, for a reason. They painted their face blue, and then this half red, and put Patriot signs or Atlanta Falcon signs or whatever it is, and they're into it. They take their shirts off and put the number and the names and all this on there because they're fanatics. They love the game. And you say you love the Lord. Where's your fanaticism? Come on now. Where you at, homie? Amen. No, I don't want you to paint a big old Jesus on your chest and come there chested. Hey, our usher may take you down at the door, though, man. You ain't coming in here like that.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
But you know what I mean? They're fanatics about what they love that game, and them men can care less about your life.
Amen.
They don't send you tithe. They don't give you money for Christmas. They don't even know your name. And you're willing to, you know what I mean, whether it's the Broncos or whoever, buying jerseys for $120 and this and that with their name on the back. And then your name is their name.
Amen.
You're fans for things like that, but you need to learn to be a fan, a fanatic for Jesus.
Amen.
Crazy Jesus freak.
Amen.
Come on now, that's what our city needs. They don't need to see religion, they see that. They need to see someone, because you used to flame yourself up all red, headband, and walking around talking about your gang, or blue. Come on now. Or whatever it was, you used to do all crazy for your body. Oh. And then you get saved, and something happens, you become I don't know what. You with me? And we need to be crazy for Jesus. You with me? We need to let the Lord touch our lives and set us on fire. I remember a preacher, he said, you know what I do? He said, all I do is go into a city and I light myself on fire and the whole city comes to watch me burn.
Amen.
And he wasn't talking physical, he was talking spiritual.
Amen.
And our city's looking for people because there's kids out there that are killing themselves. Come on now, where's the fanatics at now? Come on, some of you probably walked by these kids before and they see nothing in your life. Where's the fanatics at? Where's the people they're going to look and they're going to take notice? If somebody was lit on fire and they ran through here, you'd take notice. But if somebody just kind of nonchalantly walked through and, you know, they had their head down, this and that, you probably wouldn't pay attention to them. This one would be screaming and yelling and running and hitting walls and all this stuff because they're on fire. The other one just kind of like, I don't want to be seen. You with me? Want to blend in with the crowd. Our city's looking for people. They're looking for young people too. They're looking for people in middle school and in high school that are going to shine for Christ. Come on, they're going to flame themselves up with Jesus. Come on, you're going to. You with me? They're going to say, hey, you don't have to kill yourself. Guess what? I got the answer. His name, Jesus, called me to my youth group. Come over there and let God touch your life. Let me pray for you right now. Why? Because there's something in me, a silver and gold I might not have, but what I do have, in the name of Jesus, rise and walk. Get out from there where you're at. Because there's something inside of me. Is there something inside of you? I know you might say that. You with me? But the Bible says in James, faith without works is dead. You might say you love Jesus. You might say you're a Christian. But are they seeing anything in you that's different? Are your family seeing anything in you that's different? Do they look at your life and say, I don't know, but I was raised with my dad for many years, and that's not the same man I knew for all those years. This man's different. Somebody touched him. My mom's different. Somebody got a hold of her heart. Come on now. And it wasn't Jesus. They like, you know, the Tijuana. It was Jesus of Nazareth. Somebody got a hold of her, and she's different now. Come on, somebody. You with me? Amen. For those of you that are new, you could smile and say amen. Amen. These oldies, don't look at them. Don't follow their example, because they're all jacked up. Amen. Look around at the ones that are new and smiling, and they don't know any better, so they're laughing, they're involved. Everybody else is tripping on themselves. You with me? Just serve the Lord and live for Jesus. Amen. Amen. Love God with all your heart. Get your mind off yourself. Amen. Amen. Love God with all your heart. Amen. Amen. Work out your salvation. Work it out. Amen. I want you to know today that your salvation takes work. Your salvation takes work. Working out takes work. How many of you have a resolution? You still haven't worked out since January 1st. Or you worked out one day and that was it. And then you come on now. Your membership at the gym is just null and void, man. They're just raking in your money because you haven't been there because you're too busy. Working out takes work. Hard work. Amen. Grueling pain, sweat, tears, and sometimes even blood. Come on now. How many of you ever worked out? Man, look at everybody that. You remind me of that shirt at Walmart. I always go buy them shirts. They have the different stuff on them. It has a big old thing of fries. It says, exercise? I thought you said extra large fries. Someone get them for our church. Come on, get extra workout. Workout. Well, how does it work? I go to work. That's enough. You with me? Listen, your salvation, your walk with God, those of you that are here today that have given your life to Jesus, it takes work. It takes work to live for God. What makes you wait to hear on me? Come on, when you were a drug addict, you were a worker. You were a hustler. Even when you were a wino, you were a hustler. Come on now. My cousin used to be a drug addict and this and that, but you know what? I had respect for him. You know why? Because he wasn't on the corners having a sign that says, give me money so I go buy my habits. I go do my thing. You know what he was doing every morning? Him and his lady would be rolling burritos. And they'd be out there in the bars hustling and running and doing this. And then they'd go get their little dope. And I said, you know what? I can at least respect somebody like that. That they're hustling and they're paying for their own habit. They're not asking you for your money. But they're out hustling and doing whatever they can. And they weren't stealing or breaking into homes. They were hustling, they were doing that, and God respects a hustler. He respects a hard worker for him. And your salvation is going to take, it ain't just coming and sitting here looking pretty. Come on now, get that out of your mind. Amen. It ain't just coming, you're coming to church on Sunday all dolled up and saying, man, you know, man, this is great life, this is a great life. And then Monday through Saturday, you go live however you want, work and do all this for you. You with me? And then you with me? That's not what salvation is all about. That's not why Jesus died on the cross. God didn't send his son to come and die a brutal death on a cross, worse than any kind of you know, death sentence the world can give you.
Right.
You with me? And they killed him on that cross so that you could come and have a nice religious life. You with me? He said, if you want to follow me, deny yourself. Take up your cross and follow my example. Follow me. Do what I did. Come on, now don't come just listen to pastor at church.
Right.
And then because you're not doing it, get mad at me.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
Come on, somebody. Huh? If you're not doing that and you're walking in disobedience, rebellion, you're going to eventually get offended with me. Most of these people, when they first came in here, I was better than sliced bread, man. They loved their pastor. Used to. They loved me more than anything, you know what I mean? Because I was a representative of God. Now, we're at odds. Huh? Now, it's like, I don't listen to what he says. He just always says that. I don't have to come to church or prayer or anything like that. I just ignore him. Because I read my Bible and I pray, and so I got a hold of God now. I don't need the intercessor. I don't need the shepherd no more. I got a hold of it. Could you imagine a sheep doing that? I don't need you, shepherd. I can go do whatever I want to do. You know, them ones get eaten. There is a devil out there. He's like a wolf in sheep's clothing, and he roams around like a lion, seeking who he may devour. Some of you, he might have devoured your hearts already.
Right.
You with me? You better be careful. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Let me tell you what I'm talking about here. I already said working out is hard. It's hard work, grueling, painful, sweat, tears, and even blood at times. I don't know if you've ever worked out, but I worked out. You with me? I do. I walk a lot. I do stuff like that. And man, I'm telling you, sometimes I go home, my knees hurt so bad. Even my hips are hurting and stuff from walking miles and miles to exercise and get out there and do that. And I said, man, I need to start lifting weights, but I don't want to get bigger. You know what I mean? I don't want to look like the Hulk anymore. I want to slim down, trim down. I want to look flaquito, man. Amen. You guys are in trouble. Check this out. This is what it means to work out. It means to continually work to bring something to completion or fruition. To continually work, amen, to bring something to completion or fruition. Can I tell you, you're not done yet. Some of you have been saved just a couple of years. You with me? And you already think you're done. You already know more than the pastor. You're like Peter, or Simon, I should say. Oh, they're rebuking your pastor. What are you talking about? You're not going to do this. Oh, no, no. He said, get behind me, Satan. And I said this morning, get behind me, Satan. You have the things of men in mind. I have the things of God in mind. And we're going to fulfill the things of God in this church. We're going to do what God called us to do. We're not going to let the devil come and try and hold us back or tell us what we're going to do. Come on, the devil is a liar. To work, to continually work, to bring something to completion or fruition. Where's your fruit, baby? Where's your fruit of the Spirit? Come on now, you say you're full of the Holy Spirit, then where's the love? Where's the peace? Where's your patience at with people? Come on, now I know you expect that from me. Ain't that a trip? We expect pastor to walk in love. We expect pastor to be patient with us. Come on now. We expect pastor to have self-control and be gentle and kind, and we can do whatever we want. I don't think so. Come on, Simon. Simon, he said, Satan has desired to have you that he might sift you like wheat. He said, but I'm praying for you, Simon. I'm praying for you that your faith would not fail. I'm praying that you don't lose your salvation. Because this is a work that we're doing here. Your salvation, you just, people think, you know, I got saved and, you know, 2, 3 years ago or 10 years ago or however long ago you got saved. Listen, you started getting saved then. You came to a realization, gave your heart to Jesus. Now the real work has started. Now you're walking, now you're working, now you're having to come on, deal with you. How many times have you heard me say that the biggest problem in your life is not somebody that's in your life, but you? You're going to send yourself to hell if you don't be careful. Come on now, and that's what we have to be careful in ourselves, that we're not the ones that send us to hell. We're always blaming everybody else. It's their fault I feel like this. No, it ain't. You know why you feel like that? I can tell you right now, and I believe that the Spirit of God told me this morning, the reason you feel like that is because you have not been on those knees. And if you have, you've not been with a willing spirit. Let me show you what I'm talking about here. Working it out. How do we work it out? We do this by actively pursuing obedience in the process of sanctification. That is heavy right there. That's so heavy right there. Yeah. We work out our salvation by actively pursuing obedience in the process of sanctification. We're obeying and God's making us holy. We're working, we're going after it, and in the process, we're getting better, and God's setting us apart. You with me? See, the thing is, we think we're good. Come on now. Amen? Those around you can tell you whether you're good or not. You can go to, you know, there was a guy that one time said, went to a job interview, and like some of you do, and he went in there, and all his references, the pastor, the brother at church, come on, the mama at church. Yeah. Why? Because they know how you act over here.
Yeah.
Oh, praise God. And I've had to give references to people, you know what I mean, asking the Lord's forgiveness. Huh? Well, and this guy took his references, he took his application, his resume, whatever you call it, to his boss, and his boss overlooked it, and he's looking at it, and he says, do me a favor, he says, give me a past boss that you've worked for your references, because sometimes the pastor and the people that know you at church, they see the best in you. Give me somebody that really knows you. Give me your last boss's number. Come on. Give me your ex's number. Because all I know over here is your side. Come on, somebody. All you told me is how bad they were. And see, I haven't met them, so I don't know. But I guarantee you that if I sat with them, I'd be like, them dirty dogs. They told me all these years it was you. Now I know why you drink. It's heavy duty. Working for God. Amen? We're working for God. And like what that said. It says, we do this by actively pursuing obedience in the process of sanctification. See, God's, as we pursue obedience and we obey, God makes us holy. That's where we're working it out. See, this is, you know what God was showing me yesterday about wrought iron? And I was going to bring my lowrider bike in here because my lowrider bike has chrome forks on them that are Springer forks. For the lowrider bikes, they bounce, you know, on different stuff. But mines are different because mines are chrome, but they're twisted, and what we know is wrought iron. You know what wrought iron is?
Yeah.
No? That's what you put over your windows to keep the thieves out.
Yeah.
It's what you put on your doorstep, on your walkway to hold on to as you're walking down the out your door. It's the black iron that, come on,
yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
It's twisted. Some of it's twisted.
Yeah.
My forks on my bike are twisted, makes it look nicer, makes it look better, but there's a price to pay.
Yeah.
I was thinking about that, and I said, I thought of the song, I'm wrapped up, tied up, and I don't want to get loose. I'm wrapped up, tied up, and I don't want to get loose. So I'm wrapped up, tied up, tangled up in Jesus, and I don't want to get loose. Something got a hold on me. I don't want to get loose. Cause that, guess what? But that wrought iron didn't just at an altar when Pastor prayed for you fell down and the twisting process happened. And you know, I mean, you were made holy right there at that altar. Oh no, baby, this is every day you come into service, Pastor, that would light the Holy Ghost and heat you up, yeah, get you all ticked off and twist you in the process with your attitude and everything else. Yeah, you might be mad at me, but I'm working on you. Yeah, it hurts. Discipline doesn't feel good at the time. You're being twisted and you're being, but when you're done, baby, you're gonna be all chromed out, twisted, everything in all of you. It didn't just happen. Somewhere there's somebody in your life that God is using, and it ain't always me. You with me? It's the person next to you. Yeah. Look that way, look this way. God's using them to twist me, man. God's using them to break me. Huh? Amen. 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 See, I ain't the only bad one here, amen. Sandpaper's got its purpose. Sandpaper will rough you up, but when you're done, you'll be smooth. People see them paint jobs and think they just happen. Them paint jobs. Have you ever watched some of these Fast and Loud or these movies where these guys are rebuilding cars and doing all this? It didn't just happen. And you know what is the program? 30 minutes?
Yeah.
Them bad old black paint jobs on them trucks and lowriders and all this stuff took hundreds of hours of sanding and washing and priming and hitting and tearing and welding and hammering. Didn't happen in 30 minutes. You with me? And yours hasn't happened yet. I've been serving God 31 years and he's still working on me. Come on, now tell me you're going to have it all together now. Come on. You with me? All of a sudden, you're going to teach me a thing or two. Amen? This is what it means to fear. He said, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. This is what fear means. This is the Greek definition of fear was reverence or respect. Reverence or respect. Some of us need to learn that. Not only for the Lord. Amen. We need to learn reverence and respect for God. But then we need to learn reverence and respect for one another. You with me? Amen? Trembling means this. Trembling, he said, work out your salvation with reverence and respect and trembling. And this is what it means. It means great humility. Not just humility, great humility. And can I tell you that some of the word humility or humble, one of the words that comes from that is humiliation.
Yeah.
Humiliation. Have you ever felt humiliated?
Yeah.
Has anybody at work or somewhere ever humiliated you? Maybe your spouse humiliated you in front of everybody. Your kids, by what they did, humiliated you in front of everybody. And what are you thinking of at that moment? You're thinking, I can't believe they did that to me. I remember the day something happened on TV, and the one who was on TV was my son. And I remember feeling this. I remember the day that my daughter, I found out that my daughter, when she was only 18 years old, come from a Christian home. I remember the day that I thought and I heard, you know, from different sources, you know, that she was pregnant. And I remember what I felt inside of me, and it had nothing to do with them. They have nothing to do with my son or my daughter. Or maybe things I've heard about you. It didn't have nothing to do with you, it had to do with me and my pride. I cannot believe that. Oh my God, everybody's going to know. There's the pastor's kids. We weren't thinking about them. Man, our kids are hurting, they're in trouble, they need help. I was thinking about me. I can't believe they humiliated me and this and that. What is that? It's dealing with your pride. Remember, I told you, it's not. The God will use them to break your spirit. Break that pride. Break that. Come on now. And God uses people around you to do that. Oh man, they get you so mad and upset and this and that. God's like, dude, I'm still trying to get that out of you. When any time they ever wanted to purify gold or silver, some of you may know about that, the purifying process, they put it in heat. boil it, turn it up until it's boiling, and then it just starts getting foamy, and they call it, what do they call it, the dross. And they take a rag or something and they wipe the ugly, nasty. See, that's what the pastor does every service. Throws the trash away. Next service, turn it up. What was it on 350? Let's go 375 this service. Why? To get the ugly out of our lives. Come on now. I didn't get this handsome over 30 years. Looking like... The Lord has done a lot of work. They say, man, I was shot in the face with the shotgun. I was all jacked up in my face, my teeth, my eyes, my hair. Everything was all messed up. And the ladies, they said, you can't even tell? You look so handsome. Where did they shoot you? I said, oh, it's there. I'm just teasing. I gotta get you to laugh somehow. That made you laugh, though. Great humility. Serve the Lord with reverent respect and great humility. Work out your salvation. And this doesn't have to do with your relationship with God. I mean, it does, don't get me wrong. But I mean, everybody can come in church and say, well, you know what, you can't tell me nothing. I love the Lord. I just can't stand Him. Listen to what it says. This trembling can also refer to a shaking due to weakness. But this is a weakness of higher purpose, one which brings us to a state of dependency on God.
Amen.
See, many people, bro, many people, because we come from the same kind of lifestyle. See, many people think when you're serving the Lord, you're just a punk now. You're just weak.
Right.
I have kids get in my face before when I'm witnessing to them and tell me, you know what? I heard you Christians are nothing but homosexuals. Well, he didn't say that. He said different words. But he's like, his friends were laughing. They're all around me. And he's in my face spitting on me like that. And I had two disciples with me. And they're like, man, hit him, Pastor. And this guy was up in my face because he knew I wouldn't do nothing to him. You know, it takes more strength to do that than it does to beat somebody up. I let him know. I said, you know what? You ought to thank God I'm saved. And he said, why is that? I said, because if I wasn't saved, this is what I would do to you. I began to tell him about ripping his head off and spitting down the black hole and all this different stuff. And his eyes were like this, and he's leaning back, you know, scared to death. And I said, do you understand? Are you ready to receive Jesus? And he said, yes. Yeah. So we prayed and he accepted the Lord. Amen. But a lot of people take kindness for weakness. You with me? They take humility and humbleness and meekness as weakness. So they see these big old homeboys all tatted up on their faces and crying at the altar as punks. When they're really true. I remember Pastor Ray one time, there was a homeboy, just got out of the joint, man, like 30 years. He had tattoos, he was hard and big, but he was at the altar. He had been in the home that we have in Denver for several weeks, crying, and God, change me, and all this. And Pastor Ray said, I want you all to look at this. He said, see this man here, that's a real man of God. It takes a real man to come to the altar and deal with you. Come on, somebody. To deal with it. Listen, I'm not telling you this all puffed up saying, you know what? You don't even know. You don't even know the hours spent at the altar. The hours spent on my knees crying out to God, asking Him, God, help me, Lord.
Right.
Sometimes I don't even like, come on now. And I didn't even like who I was. Come on now. Taking it out on the wife and kids and everybody else because I didn't like who I was. That's why men beat their wives. It's not because they don't love them. They love them to death. But they hate themselves. And they take it out on them. And then they're there after feeling so bad. I'm sorry, baby. I mean, here's some flowers. How can I make it up to you? Because who was really beating was himself. He's all jacked up and he needed help. Come on now. Amen. Amen. Only met myself this morning. Fear and trembling is this: serving God with great humility and respect towards God and others, which leads us to the great problem. And I put real big letters, all caps, others. That's my problem. Amen?
Amen.
It's easy to love God because you can't see Him. What's hard is to love people we do see and rub shoulders with every day.
Right.
And you know, this must be a problem that's happening throughout the nation, because I just heard my pastor preaching on this just the other day. Not this message, but similar. And he was telling his church how you guys need to stop fighting, and you guys need to start learning how to love each other. He says, how can you love a transient on the street? You don't even know, and you'll give him $10. But you won't give your brother a dime or a dollar or a ride to church or a ride home? Come on now. He said, it's easy to love people you don't even know. What's hard is to love your love those who... And I was, you know what I was thinking about? The men in the home and the women in the home. I don't know, have any of you ever been in our men's or women's home? Any of you here? I know in the evening we got a couple that come, or you know, several. I met one last night who was one of our cousins, Ernie or Eddie? What's her name's son? He was in our home, and you know, he laughed, he did real good, and you know what I mean? But eventually they end up leaving.
Yeah.
But you know why? And it's not necessarily the leader, it's not necessarily the church. The church is magnificent, it's amazing. It's the men I have to live with every day.
Yeah.
Some of you ladies, man, you do good to go to the home.
Yeah.
Go put you over there for 1 year and bring you back over here. That's why I can't wait till Selena comes.
Amen.
If she ever comes to Pueblo. That's Sister Angela's daughter, who's been in our home for like 3.5 years.
Yeah.
Are you with me?
Yeah.
I can't wait till she comes. I'm going to put her in charge of you ladies. And I'm going to say, now teach them what it's like to be in the home.
Yeah.
Teach them what it's like, you know what I mean, to cop an attitude and go put it on a toothbrush.
Yeah.
You with me?
Right.
That's heavy duty to go over because you did wrong or whatever. Go get on a toothbrush and clean your baseboards. Thank you, Jesus. I love you, Lord. Hallelujah. I'll never talk back again. Hallelujah, Jesus. Help me, Lord. I've seen them. If you've ever been to dinner, sometimes you go by and they'll be on their knees crying. You can't even talk to them. They can't even look at you. They're crying out to God. And you're like, oh, pobrecito, pobrecito. No, 30 years, man, they've been jacked up to, you know, terrorizing their teachers, their girlfriends, and their boyfriends, and all this stuff. They need to be over there.
Yeah.
It teaches you something. Work it out, baby. Work it out. To see what they tell me that they do over here, not Crossroads, but one of the places. It's like a rehab that for all drug addicts and all this. But they said that they'll even put you in the corner and time out. Your nose in the corner for 8 hours.
Yeah.
If you are, huh? TC's, they'll put you, I don't know if it's this one or in Denver, but they said that they'll put you as a grown-up in a diaper.
Wow.
Yeah. One of our friends, one of my buddy's brothers was in there, and they had to wear diapers. They said, you want to be a baby? Could you imagine about coming in a couple people in diapers? Come on, discipline. Big old safety pins there, walking behind Riley, my granddaughter, with diapers on. Could you imagine that? Imagine seeing the pastor in a diaper, because he's acting a fool, or selfish, or... tripping. That's working it out. This is salvation. This is serving Jesus, working it out. It ain't just coming looking pretty on and tie and a nice dress. And come on now. Pastor Freddie, one time we went to a conference in San Antonio when Pastor Ray was with Freddie Garcia. And we went over there and the pastor showed up 2 minutes late for service. Two of the pastors, one was from California, one was from, Texas, not El Paso. This is from El Paso. One was from California. They came with their wives, beautiful dresses, the men had suits. These were pastors from different cities. They came 2 minutes late. Pastor Freddie said, I want them out in the front. When we went out of the service, they were on their knees and their hands cutting grass with scissors.
Wow.
Huh? And when we got to Pastor Freddie's house, all the pastors were there. We go fellowship, we went to eat. He had his yard all fixed up. Guess who was serving the meals? Them pastors and their wives. Would you like more gravy? Not on this side. Say, amen, put some gravy. On this side, say, would you like more mashed potatoes? Would you like some meat and this and that? Why? 2 minutes late. How many of you this morning would say, man, we would have been out cutting the grass this morning? I'm not talking about that that's right. I'm not saying that I would do that. I don't need to do that to you all. Come on now. I don't even do that. You guys are ready to walk out, man. Huh? It's easy to love God. Remember others. It's easy to love God because we can't see Him. Amen? What's hard is to love people we do see every day. We rub shoulders with them every day. And you know what's hard is because we're a ministry that is like the Bible, the New Testament, that every day we're at the house of God. Every day we're doing something. And the thing is you know what I mean? It's when you're around somebody every day. See, but the thing is, I don't understand you because I don't see you guys throwing a trip with your bosses at work, or at least you lie. You don't. Not that you lie, but you don't say nothing.
Right.
Huh? That you've been written up or talking back or, come on, attitude or almost fired because of the way you behave at work.
Yeah.
So you come over here and prayer and all this, and nobody knows nothing about your personal life.
Yeah.
And that's where it matters out there.
Yeah.
But see, the thing is that over here, we're always together, and we're always rubbing shoulders. Like yesterday, the Mexican dinner, we forgot to thank you guys for helping us with the Mexican dinner yesterday. Everybody that bought food, drove, helped, cooked hamburger, or whatever it was, amen. Thank you so much, because that's the way we help provide for our church. But we're always around each other. We're always doing, anytime you're doing that, there's going to be sandpaper. But you don't realize God said, iron sharpens iron. Like one man sharpens another. And they're sharpening you because you're kind of dull. And they're helping you. And you don't want to stop it, but keep rubbing and keep acting a fool because you're getting sanded. Come on. They might end up, like Beyonce said on that show, what is it, Fighting Temptations? They might end up all ugly and torn up, and you're going to end up all beautiful and smooth because of their life.
Yeah.
Don't realize they're helping you.
Yeah.
Don't realize your pastor's helping you.
Yeah.
A pastor once said this. He said, we would have the perfect church if it wasn't for this people. And you might say today, I would have the perfect marriage, Pastor, if it wasn't for my spouse. How many of you would say that today? I know somebody in the back would say that. I'd have a perfect marriage if it wasn't for Esther. I was talking about my wife. I read that I was talking about her. Oh, Lord.
Jesus.
The people that we have most, the problem that we have most of the time is people. I don't know about you, I have people problems.
Yeah.
I've always had people problems, but I have to realize, wait a minute, it's not them.
Yeah.
Well, they're always, they call it constructive criticism. No matter what I do, you know what I mean? They say, well, that should have been there, and this should have been there, and I told you to do this, and this and that, and we don't learn from that.
Yeah.
We keep making the same mistakes.
Yeah.
You with me? And then get mad because they told us something.
Yeah.
Hmm?
Yeah.
Amen. We have problems with people. Amen? Parents, Some of us, even as adults, have problems with our parents.
Yeah.
We still won't take correction. And how old are you?
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
Our parents have more wisdom than we do.
Right.
Come on.
Right.
They have more, you know, experience in life. And as they get older, they tell us stuff. My mom, I was laughing yesterday because I was just, you know, I had to get alone with God and listen to the Lord. And, you know what I mean? We have a good little relationship. But I was reminded of my mom. I said, my mom, well, you know, I was telling the other night, my mom's one of the greatest disciples New Hope Ministries of Pueblo has.
Yes.
Has been since she started coming to our church.
Yes.
Giving, serving, helping, everything she's done for us. But I said, you know, and I said, I even pastored my own mother.
Yeah.
What an honor that is.
Right.
To have her submitted to me as her pastor.
Yeah.
But she lets me know. When we're at church, you are my pastor, and I love you, and I'm submitted. But when we're at my house, me more. I'm the boss. And I understand my place. That's why I don't go over that often. She always puts me to work or something. Man, no, I'm just kidding. But I understand authority. You with me? Sometimes we have problems with our parents and we're already grown adults. We still don't know how to submit to them. And can I tell you this? That because we were rebellious as teenagers and didn't submit to our coaches, our parents, the teachers, the principals, today in life, even as a Christian, you have problems in your life because you never learned respect and reverence for authority. That's why it's good to send our kids to the military. Send them over there 8 weeks of boot camp.
Amen.
They'll come back. Yes, ma'am. Making their bed, you can drop a quarter on it, it'll bounce, and washing the dishes and doing everything, you'd be like, what did you do with my child? Because they learned something over there they didn't learn how many years in our homes? Or even us as adults. We did whatever we want. We were rebellious. I'm getting in trouble, arrested, or running away, or whatever like that. And you never learn how to submit to your mom and dad. And that's why today you have trouble with your boss at work. Come on now. Or your pastor, or whoever it is in authority. Come on. Or your husband. Say, I ain't submitting to any man. That's why you're still single. Or men as well. Huh? The problem's our spouse. The problem's our kids. If I had good kids, I'd be a good parent, right? The problem's our siblings, our brothers and sisters. How is it that you don't know how to witness to your own brothers and sisters? How is it that they don't know you're a Christian, or you don't have patience or time for them, or to call them, or to invite them, or this and that, because you know you're already done with that? You can't do that. Come on now. That's your brother and sister. You grew up with them. I don't, you know what I mean? I have stepsisters that I love dearly, but I love my brother to death. I give my heart for him, my kidneys for him, or anything I can do for him. I love him to death, and when we get around each other, we're like babies. Because the love is so deep in our hearts, we cry when we see each other. You with me? To think my brother would go to hell for eternity because I ain't got time, or you with me? It's like, man, I pray for my brother all the time. His wife, his kids, my sisters, their kids. You with me? Amen?
Yeah.
If you haven't talked to your brother and sister and this and that in years, something's wrong.
Yeah.
You need to stop.
Right.
I don't care what they did. I don't care what they're talking or how they're living or why they're not Christian. They drink and do drugs. So did you. You're all jacked up. Now we look at everybody else and don't want to talk to them because they may be jacked up.
Yeah.
Could you imagine if Jesus felt like that about you? Amen? If it wasn't for our siblings or our co-workers, our classmates, for those of you that are in school, listen to me, those of you that are in middle school, elementary school, or even high school or college, why is it you always got problems? Everywhere you go, there's somebody that's an enemy. Don't you think God's trying to finally get your attention? To say, hey, snap, do you think maybe you want to love that person? Maybe God wants you to witness to that person? Maybe pray for them. Come on, somebody. Your co-workers? How many of you got co-workers you can't even stand? And that's not right for you as a Christian.
Right.
Everybody at church, at work, ought to love you. You with me? Yeah, they're going to mock and they're going to say that and this and that, but listen, pray for them. Yeah. You know, I had a boss. The last place I had worked, I had a boss. I think it was, no, it wasn't. But when I was with the TAP program, working with the autistic kids and stuff, I had a boss who, man, he was always on me and this and that. And I'd pray for him, like, man, God, help me learn to love this man and stuff. And he was always, you know, I don't know if it was this male ego thing or what, and he wanted just to let me know he's the boss. And I had to submit to that. I had to surrender to that. And I had to learn to love him, respect him, and pray for him. And do you know, it wasn't long after that that I had went to Vineland Middle School to work, and they told me, they said, yeah, they found Mr. So-and-so. Man, this guy was rich, this guy had money, a beautiful wife, and all this stuff, brand new Jeep, the nice new Jeeps, all lifted black, and all this stuff. And I used to think, man, this guy's got everything. And they said, yeah, he went home and blew his brains out. And I said, wow, I guess all that other stuff doesn't matter. All that other stuff you're working so hard for, the new cars and big houses and the spouse. And I think it was because his wife was cheating on him. Hey, Messi, some of you, come on now. I need you, Jesus. Huh? Co-workers, classmates, bosses. These people, I put. But just like working out, we need resistance or weight to work our muscles. Amen? You know what I was thinking of? I have some in my office. Sometimes I'll pick the little weights up, just sitting there studying or listening as I'll be working, lifting, curling or something, you know. And I wanted to bring them out here. I'm not the kind like to use, my wife does that, you know what I mean? She uses props and all this stuff. I just tell you. But I was thinking, if you could picture in your mind the YMCA and all them weights, you know, they have the 2.5 pounds that we like, then the 5 and the 10s and the 25s and the 35s and 45s. And I said, if you can only just picture those as people in church, then ones you have a hard time with. See, it's not the people that love you and are there patting you on the back and telling you what a great person you are that you know what I mean, that are going to grow you. Yeah. It's the one that, like I said, at work, you can't say, you look at them, they're smiling, laughing, you think they're talking about you and all this stuff. You know, them are the ones, that, yeah, them are the weights. Yeah. Some are just little Clifford and some are big problems, maybe bosses or supervisors or whatever, big, and you have to use those weights, and that if you want to grow, and if you want, come on now, you want to exercise, you want to do that, the people are the weights, the people are resistance, huh? They're the resistance, the people in your life, they're resisting you, but they're causing you growth, entiendes? This, people, you know, your pastor's causing you to grow up. I put this, I said, but just like working out, you need resistance or weight to work your muscles. And I put in parentheses, dumbbells. See, that was the speaker, you paused for effect there. That's like, so we're learning speech, right? Some of you ain't gonna get it, or you watch the video. Oh, dumbbells, that's what he's calling them, dumbbells. No, that's what you call them. But not that quite nice word, amen? People are those weights and the resistance that you need to grow. Amen? That's what tells you that's why the word tells you to love your neighbors as yourself. To love your wife, to love your husband, to love your enemies. Come on, some of you got some growing to do. We're still trying to love those who love you. Yeah, you haven't even learned to love your enemies. Come on now. What is the first thing that happens to us in our marriages? When there's so much resistance and so much weight and problems, what's the first thing we think of? See ya. The big D. Come on. What does it mean? I quit. I give up. I don't want to deal with this. I'm out. You're not worth it. Huh? That's, come on now. That's what we used to do. But now you're a Christian. See, God put that elastic thing on you. I'm praying for you, Peter. That your faith, what he did was he had his hand behind him. He was hooking that loop there on his belt with the elastic rope. What he said was, I'm praying for you, but when you go on, you're going to be pulled back to where you're supposed to be over there at church. Because I'm not going to let you run. I've got you, Peter. I've got you, and I'm going to change you. And I'm praying for you that you're not going to give up on the greatest thing in your life, your faith in God.
Amen. Amen.
Love is the motive for everything a Christian does. Why do we put up with people? You guys don't even know. I hear some of you sometimes, you might work with one person. And you call a pastor out complaining. I can't deal. I don't know what to do. I don't know how I'm going to get through this. These people. One person. Huh? We've worked with thousands of people in our ministry over 20 years. And 10 on top of that with other churches. And the greatest thing that I came to understand is that, you know what I mean, Christianity is about a great God who loves people.
Amen.
And we claim to have this heart. And we can't love the person that's next to us. We can't honor, we can't give respect, we can't, come on, the person that we married, the person we gave, ladies gave birth to, you can't even stand your own children.
Right.
What does that say about our heart? What does that say about our character? That we're to be good over here? See, that's religion. Religion is putting on your best and coming and sitting in a church and amen, praise the Lord. And then you go home and people don't know you're a Christian.
Amen.
You go to work, they don't even know that they're a Christian.
Yeah.
I was talking, me and Jerry, one time we went somewhere and I was telling them, yeah, there's people right there. I said, man, they were in our church and I worked with them. And Jerry, he couldn't get it. He's like, no. Them? I said, yeah. He's like, no. They got saved. Sometimes we live a life out there that people don't see Jesus in us.
Yeah,
right. Our bosses, our co-workers, our family, our friends, our neighbors, people around us do not see Jesus in our lives.
Yeah.
That's what they're supposed to see.
Right.
Our motive for everything we do is love.
Right.
I'm almost done, so don't get overheated, amen? Love is the motive for everything you should do as a Christian. See, everything you did before was motivated by lust.
Yeah.
Amen.
Your relationships, they were motivated by love. You thought it was love, but it was them one night stands.
Right.
Oh, I'm sorry. I must be talking to those people on YouTube over there, because you all got it all together, right? I mean, you lived Virgin Mary lives and all that stuff. You had immaculate conceptions and all that stuff. So I got it to sometimes just pray for me, amen? I thought I was working with the church here, but first and foremost is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And the second commandment is like it, love your neighbor as you do yourself. So it's easy to love those who love you too. They love you. But I tell people this, bro. I seen some boxers yesterday. I told the lady cutting my hair, I said, you know, I used to raise boxers. I used to breed boxers. I love boxer dogs. I said, but my female, she loved her children. But she didn't love anybody else. She loved me, of course. My wife, because we better. But you come around, she's going to not love you. She loved her children. I said, so if a dog can love her own children, what makes us any different?
Right.
You know what makes you different as a Christian? That you love other people.
Right.
That you love people that aren't yours.
Right.
Come on. And not just your family members.
Right.
but loving the widows and the orphans and people. Come on now, we got a bunch of people that come to our church.
Amen.
We got, you seen the youth we got, right? I was laughing at my mother-in-law, I don't know if she's here, but all these boys call her grandma. And all the kids call my wife grandma.
Yeah.
So they're at the church, Oski, KK, all these, now we got black and white and brown, and they're all saying, grandma! And the people are like, you look as old as they do, but they're calling you grandma, and they're different races, different age groups, come on now.
Amen.
Huh? What binds all that together, love? That God can love you. He can love every race, every gender, come on now.
Amen.
That He loves us just the way we are, and that's what we're supposed to do too. Amen?
Yeah.
It's easy to love those that love you, to love those who treat you well, but to love somebody who you believe mistreated you, this is where you really learn what true love is.
Yeah.
What God's love is. Forgiveness. Hmm? It's easy to love everybody that day. Pastor. What's hard is to love those who are rebellious and disobedient. Come on. Even our children, don't get me wrong, you do the same thing. You love one and hate the other. You're like the Lord. You say, man, I'm like the Lord. God loved, Jacob and Esau. God loved Jacob and hated Esau. Some of you are like that. Say, I love this one, but I hate that one. Them are your kids. Come on now. But it's not really that you hate them. It's just that you have issues because they're your problem.
Yeah, right.
Huh?
Yeah.
No, they're just like you. That's the problem. Huh? Jesus forgave those who crucified Him on a tree. We also are called to walk in love and forgive. I'm almost done. I just got a few scriptures. Ephesians 4:32 says this. It says, get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, harsh words, and slander, as well as all types of evil behavior. Instead, be kind to each other. Now, can I tell you, this is not just for Pastor Vince?
Yeah.
Come on now.
Yeah.
This is for you.
Amen.
Huh? He said, instead, be kind to each other. You're supposed to be kind to people around you. He said, tender-hearted, forgiving others, forgiving one another. He said, just as God, through Christ, has forgiven you. Colossians chapter 3, verse 13, it says, since God chose you to be the holy people that He loves, you must clothe yourselves with tender-hearted mercy, kindness, humility. I hope you wrote these down. I hope you're listening to this. If not, go back on Craigslist, on YouTube, and listen to this message again. I go listen to my messages again. Every time I get saved. It's good stuff, man.
Amen.
Kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Make allowances for each other. I make allowances for you guys.
Amen.
Come on, somebody.
Amen.
You think I... Come on now.
Yeah.
How long have I been working with you?
Amen.
You with me?
Amen.
And maybe one time you're going to hold that against me?
Right.
How dare you?
Mm-hmm.
Make allowances for each other's faults. And forgive anyone who offends you. And forgive anyone who offends you.
Amen.
Remember, the Lord forgave you, comma, so you must forgive others.
Amen.
Above all, He said, clothe yourselves with love, which binds us all together.
Amen.
You know, it's like the rope that binds all the pearls together.
Amen.
That whole thing holding all those beautiful pearls is love.
Amen.
Hmm? He said, above all, He said, clothe yourselves with love, which binds us all together in perfect humility, perfect harmony, excuse me. That was Colossians 3, 12 through 14. And the last one is John 13, 34 and 35. It says this, "So now I am giving you a new commandment." So there is actually 11 commandments.
Amen.
Not 10. This is the 11th one that Jesus gave to us. Just as important as the other 10.
Amen.
Love each other.
Amen.
Just as I have loved you.
Amen.
He says you should love each other. He says your love for one another will prove to Pueblo
Amen.
That you are my disciples.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Am